morning to all of you, and a warm welcome to our mentor, Dr. Ostfeld. Thank you for accepting our invitation to be the mentor of this mentor meeting, Immunet e-meeting. This is the first time. As everybody already know, Dr. Ostfeld is a scientist of the Center of Experimental Rheumatology at the University Hospital of Zurich. And maybe if you agree, we can start with the presentation of the mentees. Maybe give you your name, your position, and the institution where you are working. Morten, for example, if you want to begin.
I can do that, sure.
Yes. So,
Morten Aagaard Nielsen is my full name, MD, currently a PhD student at Aarhus University, in the part of Denmark just attached to on top of Germany. And I'm finishing off my PhD in this year in 5 to 6 months time. And then I will start or continue my clinical training and apply for postdoc funding alongside for a shared position. So just to give you an idea of where I am and where I'm aiming to continue. And then my research interests are in T-cell receptors and on fibroblasts, stromal compartment, and how these cells affect the disease, and whether we can modulate these subsets or receptors in order to improve the treatment or lack of treatment that we see in some of our patients currently. So that is what I aim to continue working on and what I have been working on for around 5 or 6 years now.
So really lab work you're doing, wet
lab. Yeah, it's wet lab work, a lot of cell things and mechanistic stuff, but in the more translatory part of the basic research.
Yeah.
Nice. So that's where I find myself. And I like it, and I am now in a position where there's a lot of interesting opportunities, but also a hard time navigating, finding the best way ahead. So that's what I'm dealing with right now. Wonderful to be part of this thing. I was a part of this mentor-mentee meeting once 3 years ago, I think, with Christopher Buckley, and that was also a very lovely meeting, providing some good ideas and also meeting the other mentees, I think is also also cool. So yeah, happy to be part of this and look forward to this hour with you.
Right.
I will shut up for a while, sorry.
Eduardo, if you want to introduce yourself.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I was actually on time, but my laptop is slightly dying, so it was taking time to reset. And by the way, my name is Eduardo. Dr. Ostfeld already knows me from the...
Yeah, you already had
I work in the William Harvey Research Institute in London, especially the Argos group in the Experimental Medicine and Rheumatology Department. And I work with Professor Bombardieri. So they work mainly on Sjogren's syndrome, while me and Elisa Corsera, we work on rheumatoid arthritis. And I've been focusing during my PhD. At the moment, I'm waiting for my viva, and thanks to the pandemic, has been postponed 5 times. I worked on mainly on fibroblasts, on the role of fibroblasts in interaction with other B cells, and but also on the role of the Epstein-Barr virus in B cells in interaction with synovial cells. So it's quite a lot of actors in my PhD. But some results are coming, and I'm quite happy. And actually, yes, I'm finishing my PhD, and at the moment, I think I will stay in the Argos lab, and I would like to keep working on fibroblast subset. And at the moment, we are the technique I'm more involved and I've done in the last year is the 10x genomic.
Okay.
What are fibroblast people? That's really nice. A couple of years ago, that wouldn't have been the case.
The next will be Arani.
Hi everyone, my name is Arani. I'm sorry, I don't know why my video is not working. I am here. I'm a academic clinical fellow based in the University of Manchester in the UK. So my time is mainly clinical, and I'm starting my rheumatology training in August, having completed my medical training. And I have some time to do research. And I've currently been working with Will Dixon, looking at digital epidemiology, so monitoring patients' rheumatological conditions through smartphones and apps. I've really enjoyed that. And my long-term plan is to apply for funding for a PhD, which I'd like to do. And then my future plan is to try and build like a clinical academic career in rheumatology going forward. And I've attended some of these meetings before, and I actually met Will Dixon, my supervisor, through this mentor-mentee meeting a couple of years ago. So yeah, it's a really great initiative, and I'm looking forward to learning from you all.
That's nice.
Diego, if you want to introduce yourself.
I'll just make a short introduction because I've been an add-on. I'm Diego Benavén from Spain. I'm a consultant rheumatologist. I just finished my residency last week. And I'm still working in Hospital La Paz in Madrid. And I started my PhD last month as well. I'll be doing it on axial spondyloarthritis with Dr. Navarro. I'm really happy to be joining these mentor-mentee meetings that I have experienced before. And I'm currently working in the working group, in the peer-mentoring group, subgroup. Thank
you. Good.
And the last, I'm Silvia. I'm an Italian rheumatologist, and I finished my PhD last year, and I went for 1 year in Geneva to do some research on T and B cells in systemic sclerosis. And actually, I'm a postdoctoral research fellow at the University Hospital of Brescia in the north of Italy. And now I'm the leader of the new leader of the peer mentoring subgroup in Munich.
Very good.
So in the first part of this meeting, I have here some questions to be addressed to our mentor. Different questions. Dr. Rosbelt, if you agree, could you talk a little bit about you and your work, maybe with a particular focus of on some turning points of your career? In particular, when did you realize that you wanted to push your career in research?
So that is always what shall I say, difficult, because I think that is something, how to decide for your career is probably something really individual. And for me, it was that I was not the person at all who said during studies already, okay, this is what I want to do. I will do research and I will go in this field. So I was more the type that I said, I want to look at different things. I always had the tendency to go actually to the operating room. I loved all the atmosphere and everything. But then somehow I missed a bit the brain work. So I thought maybe I should try again a bit more lab work. And I did my doctorate thesis in malaria, actually. So totally different. I also like tropical medicine a lot. So I had a lot of different ideas what I could do. And then the turning point was that I got my dad actually said, why don't you look at the rheumatology in Zurich? There is this really great boss. And if you don't decide yet what to do, maybe you can work there in the lab because they have a great lab and he's a nice person. And then you can do a year or two there. And then maybe you decide what you do. And so I applied there. And so totally blind. I didn't even want to go in rheumatology, to be honest. I just thought I don't know a lot about lab work. So this is something I need to learn. And then this was Stefan and Renate Guy, where I applied, and the two of them were just for me the perfect match. I mean, they were very open, very collaborative. They immediately engaged with me and said, great that you're here. We could meet somebody like you. From the first day in the lab, I felt actually at home. And I was very lucky that I got a position there. So I got a fixed position there. Now, that is, of course, very important. I think in research is always the point with funding, and they had just a position open. And also through this position, I was very much involved in whole, not only in my projects, but in the whole lab organization, in biobanking, in how we do ethics things. And even so, at the moment, this was maybe a bit annoying for me, I have to say, in hindsight, that was really important that I got involved also in these things, because this made me, at the end of the day, a full lab member. You know, somebody that just pipettes what you want to do is in a way exchangeable. You know, you can give to anybody a protocol and he or she can pipette. But after a couple of years, actually, I had my own projects and I was responsible for getting the samples for the biobank. I was the one who was looking that the organization of the internal meetings was doing. I did some stuff for the, we were in big EU grants, so I did all the reporting there. And this really made me at the end of the day a valuable team member. And so I stayed, of course, there, but I still wanted to see something else. And then we had a great collaboration with Paul Peter Tuck in Amsterdam. And he said, why don't you do your PhD? We could actually, you can do it in Amsterdam, we can do an exchange. And then I did this and I spent a couple of months in Amsterdam and I did my PhD there. And then I came back and was worked again in Zurich. So my CV is quite stable in Zurich, which is not very classical. A lot of people move, and I would actually say in hindsight, I should probably have moved a bit more, but my position in Zurich was maybe too comfortable. But so the really important points when I now look back were for me that I had a really great place where I felt welcome. I felt that I was needed, that I could contribute a lot, that I was supported because of that. And that we had great collaborations that at the end of the day gave me this input that I could do my PhD in Amsterdam, but also that I, even so I didn't leave Zurich, I really, we worked together with people all over the world and we were connected a lot. And I think that is really something that at the end of the day also for me made it easier to follow the career path. The more people you know, also ImmuNet. I mean, ImmuNet was for me a great start into my research career. And this was also something Stefan Guy told me, you know, you are these young people, they want to do something, go there, there's a meeting. And I was like, oh my God, what is this? But you have to be open. And I went there and at the end, we ended up doing all these working groups and I was a working group member. And I was then I was always in the visibility subgroup and we organized all these meetings. And then I was also chair, which I got really pushed into most of these things. But the difference made that I didn't say no, you know, I said, yes, yeah, why not? I will do it. And this really made me now that I can say that I know a lot of people, I worked with a lot of people and I got insight in a lot of different labs and organizational things. And from that I still profit, I have to say, you know, it's always valuable if you are the person that people come to because they said, didn't you do this once? And didn't you work with that one? And don't you know this guy? And so this is really something that I have to say, worked very well for me.
Okay. And now I know that the main interest of your group is the analysis of innate immune mechanism and epigenetic changes that activate synovial fibroblasts in rheumatoid arthritis. But why did you choose this field as your research focus? It was your main interest from the beginning. And what advice do you have for choosing a research area for a PhD, and what factors should we take into account when deciding which project supervisors and research group to work with?
Yeah, so that is also, I mean, I was, when I started, for me, I think it didn't really matter what, I was totally open to what I would look at. But then again, I have to say, Stefan Guy was so engaged and motivated and he loved this his work so much that you just got it along. And then Chris Buckley, who is actually also in Fibroblast, is a similar type and we collaborated a lot. And also he's such a guy, you know, when you talk with them about fibroblast, it's like for them the greatest thing in the world. So I think you have to find somebody who really believes in what he does, who is really engaged in what he's doing and believes in that is important, you know. And then you in a way got torn with it, you know, and I think I got from these people that at the end of the day, a lot of things are important. I mean, B cells are important, T cells are important. It's very important to do epidemiology work. But if you if you can be motivated, or if you find somebody who really sparks your interest in this, then follow these people. Because I have to say, during, especially in research, I think also in clinical work, but in research you have up and downs, you know. You have times where you really think, oh, everything I'm doing is just not good, and why I'm doing this. And then you need to be in an environment that believes in that, you know. If around you, then also people say, yeah, actually you anyway do the wrong thing, then that will not work, you know. And we always had a bit, in our lab, it was always the atmosphere that we are like the, you know, we are the fibroblast people, and all the fibroblast people in the world, actually, there were not so many in the beginning. So it was actually Chris Buckley, and it was us, and it was Gary Firestein, and then in Amsterdam they did some work. We are like, you know, the fighters for the stromal work. And if you have something like this, you know, where you can really engage with, and where you think, okay, I feel that here I'm welcome, and I can do something. That's much more important than saying, oh, B cells were the thing I always wanted to do. So it's much more the environment than the topic itself, I would say.
Okay, so the role of the mentors and the role of the environment, I understand. And now you are recruiting people for your lab, of course. And what elements are essential when you plan to establish your own lab, other than funding? And what do you look for when recruiting new students to your lab, new students or new PhD, new postdoc?
Mm-hmm. So also there, I have to say, I'm an absolute believer into communication and social engagement. I mean, that is also why I think ImmuNet is so great, collaborations are great. And I think that is very, from the beginning, is very important that people know you, you know. They should not know the group or the work or the paper. They should know you, they should have your face, because at the end of the day, when people look for a reviewer or an expert or somebody that speaks or somebody they want to invite in a committee, they go through the people they know and not through the papers or through the groups. They think and said, oh, I once met this person and that person. So I think the social contact, direct social contact, is very important. So when I look for people, or when I look at my team, I want to have people that can do that, you know. Of course, it's important that these people know how to work in the lab and are diligent and everything. But at the end of the day, they have to stand up there, they have to present their work, and they have to make an impression that people can talk to them, that they enjoy to talk about their work, that they can answer questions. You know, I had so many times that you go to a meeting, you give your talk, and at the end of the talk, people come and ask. And if it's a good atmosphere, then more and more people come. And at the end, we were like 5 or 6 people standing around discussing your work. You meet people. But for such an environment and something like this to happen and make new collaborations and maybe find positions, you know, also, you have to have a certain openness and ability to present your work, to think along your work, you know. So the least I want is a pipette robot, you know. You want to have a person that can present his or her work, that can present your lab, and that can add also something to it, and not just, you know, go through a protocol and finish the work. So it needs more social skills also than some people think, you know. Some people think, I can be in the lab and if my duplicates are perfect, then I will be recognized in the field, but that's not the case, unfortunately.
Okay, and what advice would you give to mentees that maybe have a difficult time during their PhD, maybe due to lack of support and teaching, sometimes happen, and would you recommend them to move to another lab, maybe before the end of the PhD, or would you hire such a postdoc, maybe who will need to be training, if you are, if they are motivated, because sometimes the things go bad and
yeah. So that's very difficult. I think that is one of the worst situations, because I have to say, of course, if somebody comes and says, I don't have support and I don't get the teaching, you're always a bit suspicious. I mean, it's always two sides to a coin, and you never know, you know, where the problems really are. But of course, there are situations where you say, let's say my supervisor just moved somewhere and now I'm already left alone. I think so there are situations where I totally understand that and where I think, of course, then you have to find another group to work in. But I would always advise to try to stand through a bad time. I mean, there are possibilities to maybe find a mentor outside, to do collaborative projects where you can get teaching there. Because as I said, also in research, I mean, there are sometimes times where you have to go through, and for a PhD, if it depends a bit in which level they are. So if they're almost finished, I would say just try to finish this decently, you know, make a line under it, stand it through, and then go and move on. If you are at the beginning and you see it's not working at all, then it's probably best to just say it was different than I expected, you know. But at the end of the day, even so it's of course is a very bad situation and it's not ideal, but it will also, you will learn through this, you know, that it's not always the ideal environment, that sometimes you have to just, it's also true that not every project is a Nobel Prize project. I mean, I once had a discussion with a guy and he's told me, you know, every project you start, you have to think this goes into nature. And I was like, I mean, we have to be realistic. Not every project goes into nature. I mean, if you only say, I only do this when I go to nature, science or cell, I mean, then we end up doing really, we just have to be realistic. I think some projects, you just have to say, I have to say that I finish this decently, that I do what I can. If I can finish this with a publication, that's good. But you cannot expect, you know, that everything will be super interesting. You get what you want. You have a supervisor that teaches you everything. Sometimes life is tough and you have to move on. But you should try to finish things, you know, not to run away in the middle. Really try to find a decent ending and say, look, I did this. That was my part. And now I can move on. Because otherwise the problem is if you get a bit the reputation of, yeah, but you know, the first problems, he just quit or she just said, no, I don't get support. It's very dangerous and people talk a lot with each other. So if I get a student like this, I will phone the supervisor and say, look, what was going on? I need to hear both sides. And so it's a very, very delicate situation. I would say try as long and as hard as you can to finish this decently. And then if we really think there's no way out, if you tried with collaborations and teaching and from other groups, you know, often you're also not alone in the university. There are maybe other groups where you can say, maybe I can do a part with them or so. But with the training for me is always at a certain level. So if somebody finished studies, I think I give them that they have the capability to learn things. So if they're motivated, I think everybody can learn anything at this stage. So for me, it doesn't actually matter too much what background they have. We had people that came full clinic, they didn't have a pipette in their hand, never ever again. And half a year later, they were doing basic research, no problem at all. So I think the training is always a matter of your mindsetting, you know. I mean, I think people that come at this stage, they're intelligent, and when they want to learn something, they can. You know, it's not that I say, oh no, but if you never did this, then it's getting tough. I think there's always time to learn something. So that wouldn't be a problem at all for me.
Okay, so I understand. At the end, I have probably the most difficult questions. How do you balance clinical work, research work, and family life?
Very difficult. And I think also there, it needs time until you worked it out. And there's probably not one recipe for all. I found out that for me, what works very well is to keep these worlds really separate. So I don't do clinical work. That is already a good thing. But also in combination of clinical and research work and with research and family and clinic and family. If I'm at home, I try to be at home. And if I have to do something, then I really take this hour or 2 hours and I go away. I maybe go in the lab. So I'm also today, I'm in the lab, I'm away. Because it makes both sides unhappy when, you know, the family feels that you're not fully with them. and you feel that you cannot really finish your work. So at the end, it takes long and you don't do good work. So if I'm at work, I'm at work. I work through. I don't do a lot of socializing at work, I have to say. I eat lunch in front of my desk. I learn to be very, very efficient. And the same at home. When I'm at home, I'm at home. Also there, I'm with my kids. I do the things I have to do. And I think at the end of the day, it's all about organization, about triage in a way. You always have to think what has been done, what needs to be done immediately now, what is important, what can be done other way. To-do lists, but not in a way that I just list everything that I have to do, but really prioritize. And that worked really well. So for me, I already feel happy. I have in my calendar three things that I need to be done, no matter private or at work. And if I finish this, everything that I can do extra is a bonus, you know. And I set my deadlines. So if I have a deadline on Monday, I will put this in my calendar that I have finished it the Monday before, because I know probably that I will not manage, but I will then have, I never come into stress. If I set my deadline at the last moment, I will always be in stress and I will always end up doing things the weekend before. So I really cheat myself in always setting the deadlines earlier that they are, and I try to stick to them and not overload the calendar with to-do lists that I know I will anyway never do. So really be realistic, write the things that have to be done. And even if it's birthday of my daughter, then this needs to be done. So that's it. Then you have to no compromise. And the same with work. Some things at work have to be done. And then the kids and the partner and family just have to wait. That's the way it is. But mixing both things is very difficult. I once had, when my little boy was really, really small and he didn't want to drink from the bottle. And we had a meeting in Geneva. And I talked to a colleague and I said to her, look, at the worst case, I will just take him along. And then we just do it. And she was like, no, don't do that. That's the worst, because you will be at the meeting. You will always think, I have to go back there and give the bottle. And then when you're there, you're stressed because you think, oh, actually, I should be at the meeting. And you end up being just horribly tired and haven't done anything. And I think that's really true. You know, it's what actually worried me a bit during this corona time, because it was exactly like this. You were always going back and forth. At the end, I thought, I'm a terrible mother and I'm a terrible scientist, because I work the whole day and I get nothing done and my kids are unhappy. And so now I'm much more happy. I'm in my lab. I know I can do my things. Then I go home and I talk with my kids, and they don't have the impression that I'm always on the phone or typing something. So keep it divided. And I think the same is for the clinical work a bit, you know, because also for the patients, I mean, you have to take care about your patients when they're there. And you cannot on the side always think, oh yeah, then I quickly between two patients, I can maybe quickly do this. It will not really work well, I think.
Yes, probably for a physician that want to do research, it is the main problem, because to match the two activities is not a good idea, I think.
Yeah, no, exactly. And you need to have, I mean, a lot of people say what we have also here, which is a bit annoying, that you have the research area totally separated from the clinical area. And it's a hassle, because you have to move forward and back. And for us with the samples, it's a problem. But for the people in clinic, they say it's actually great, because I know I have one day research and then I'm at the research institute. So nobody runs into my door. Nobody just quickly asks, can we have a look at this patient, or can you quickly do this, you know? So then they know at this day, they're really there for research. And it makes such a difference if you have 5 hours in a row concentrating on a thing, or if you have half an hour, 10 minutes doing something else, come back another half an hour doing something else. It will just never work out at the end. You never dig into the things very much if you're always disturbed by something else.
No, I agree with you. When I did my PhD, I went to Geneva to do only lab work, only for one year. And then in Brescia, we have an organization, because in which I did the clinical work for 2 days in my week, and for 3 days I did the lab work, because I need to separate the two stuff.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's a mess. So now there is a space for a discussion. Do you have other questions to be addressed to Dr. Rosberg?
So just a comment or a thought based on what you said, Caroline, with the question about difficult times during a PhD, and with some of you guys going just looking to start a PhD project. What have been working for me has been to not only look at the PhD as a matter of creating products, but more flipping the coin to look at how it's a training program. So how can I obtain qualifications? How can I obtain skills? How can I seek new adventures that will provide me with tools so that I can be useful in the future? So really the PhD is the first step, and there's no need for the PhD publication to be grand, great, or anything. So it's just, and yeah. I think that can be a big stressor. It has also been for me back and forth, like that you want this paper coming out of the PhD to be very, very good.
I mean, sometimes you focus so much also just in the training and skill part. And sometimes you hit a wall, you know, just because you spend like, I have to say that I've learned more from the human point of view than from the, obviously also from the technical skills. But when I arrived, I was like, you know, I had to prove something. So sometimes I really spend in a lab like all the time, and like 12 hours, 15 hours, which is, I mean, I know that in some cases normal because it's requirement, but I think at a certain point was too much. And sometimes you see people that sleep in the lab and then you start after a few years, you see that guy was sleeping here. It's like a sort of run between people. And then you realize there is people who like works 6-7 hours and they are so efficient. So I think sometimes it's, as Caroline was saying, it's more about efficiency than anything else, because I remember there were a couple of guys, they were living in the lab, but then their efficiency was basically zero. And I realized that after months, and that, you know, I was impressed by something that was not actually impressive. And that's when I started to claim my life back. That is the moment in which I think halfway through the PhD, I started to be a little more efficient, scientifically wise too. So less time, but better.
Yeah, and I can just say to that efficiency part, yeah. So one thing is you cannot do everything, you know, and also what Morten mentioned, you need some skills and some expertise, and you need some things that you are good at and some things you might not be good at, and it might not be perfect, and then you just ask somebody else to do it. So how you get this expertise is that you can take courses, you can go for a couple of months to another lab to learn something, you know, the EULA, for instance, has these scientific bursaries, and it should always be in a way in a certain field, you know. What also somebody once told me, which I found quite good, is in a way, after certain years in research, you need to get your house number, you know. People, when they see you, when they meet you, they need to have an idea of what you can and what you do. There is no sense in saying, yes, then I worked a bit on this, and then I did a bit of this, and a bit of this, and a bit of that. That might be good in the beginning, but after a while, you know, you must have your house number. You must know, you have your field of expertise. That's where you're good in. So for me, was really with the fibroblasts. So I was a bit pushed into this, and with the epigenetics. So then these were the fields where I tried to learn as much as I could. I was the one who went to non-rheumatology meetings on epigenetics, you know, to get this into it. So this then was really a field where I could say, okay, this is where I want to bring the expertise and where I would learn. There are other fields where I have no idea, you know, that I just say, look, ask. It's important to know people that know it, but you cannot know anything. But you need to have a couple of things where you are the one, you are the person that people come to. And do this good, and this had also to do with efficiency. You cannot do everything. It's better to do a couple of things really, really good and be known for that,
then do everything a little bit and never finish anything, you know. That is just will just confuse yourself and also people around you that never really realize what you are standing for, you know, what you're actually doing.
Related to this, Dr. Ospel, do you think that we can then have two fields of expertise? Let's say that we can work on two different things that are even not related and still be good at them?
I mean, yes, you can, if it's not five. You know, I think two or three fields is fine, but it's not five. I mean, a lot of people now, for instance, started with COVID work, which I think is great, is interesting. But if you're already doing, you know, I'm interested in vasculitis, I do RA work, I'm interested in gene therapy, and now I also want to do COVID, after a time, you know, it's also very important in the lab that you can combine experiments. So sometimes, or approaches, you know, so sometimes you use the same approach in different fields, and then you can be very variable, but at the end of the day, you always do the same thinking, the same methodology. But it gets problematic if you have a different field and a different methodology. And then, you know, you can never combine your work, and then it will just get too much, you know. And yeah, you will kill yourself at the end. In you cannot dance on too many weddings, you know, that's just the thing. But of course, you can do a couple of things, yeah. That's not a problem.
Yes, maybe the solution could be to follow a little bit the field of your group, but also to have something new to bring to the group, probably. Because sometimes it's not easy to bring something new when you finish the PhD, maybe. In my case, I went to Geneva, I have a particular environment. I come back to Italy, it's completely different, as you can imagine, but I'm trying to bring something new in my center. But you have to be lucky to have person who hear you and they say, yes, Silvia, it's a good idea, maybe we can do it. And then you must have also some biologist or other person who help you.
So, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I think you said two very important things. One is luck. It's always, I mean, if I come back, sometimes I think, wow, I was so lucky that I met this guy, this person. I was so lucky that this project was just opening or that I got this grant. It's a lot about luck and this. And it's for everybody. I mean, it's not, I haven't met anybody who said, yes, everything I did worked. And you know, it's always a bit of luck. And I see now when I'm in this grant committees, sometimes the decisions, they are so tiny, you know, it's not really that people are worse or better. It's just at the time, at this setting, the one had just a bit, little bit more and you have to decide. So it's really not mostly decided really clearly. Mostly it's really little things that decide. And the other thing is the people. So if you meet people that you think these can bring you forward and these are great, stick to them. Really, it's really important to have somebody that you can, as you said, that hears you, you know, that supports your ideas and everything. If you don't have, of course, you can stay there for a couple of years and you can finish your things. But then you should really watch out for these people that bring you forward, because nobody can do it alone. That's just, for me, impossible. If you don't have somebody that supports you inside or outside, you need to be, I mean, you need the support of somebody and you have to find somebody. So go out there, present yourself and talk to people. I mean, sometimes they can come from really sides that you don't expect, you know, that you have a total different, that you meet somebody through something totally different and then you see they can actually help you a lot in some respect. So, yeah, this is, yeah, find people that help you and that inspire you.
Okay. Do you have other questions for Dr. Ospelt, Arani maybe, or?
Yes, if I may, to Dr. Ospelt and the group. So I'm just asking what advice you have for junior researchers who are looking for what to do their PhD in, both project, mainly project wise, and what advice do you have in making those decisions?
Yeah, that's also difficult. I mean, we have a lot of interviews with, so how it works in Switzerland is that you apply for a postgraduate program. You can choose from certain groups that give you a selection of their projects, and then the students come and they visit 4 or 5 labs and talk to the supervisors. And I always think, the poor ones, I don't want to be in their shoes, you know, it's so difficult to, in this one interview, to decide which PhD project, which group and everything to decide, or to find these people. What can I say? I think it's a combination of, again, of talking to people who are in the labs, you know, maybe somebody says, look, this is a great opportunity. Maybe you can find it there. Of course, it must be a topic that you're interested in, but if it's a great opportunity, if somebody says, no, look, we get so great support and this is so great, that can be something totally different. So I would always prefer a good environment and a good supervisor to the research topic. So don't be too fixed on the topic that you want to do. You can still in your postdoc or any, you know, there are a lot of interesting things. I would always prefer to have a great environment. To find out what is the great environment, of course, I mean, people don't come to you when you visit the lab. They don't say, don't come here, it's horrible. So it is a bit difficult to find. But I think sometimes, you know, to be able to go there or say you want to visit a lab meeting, maybe join a lab meeting, then maybe you see how people present their work and how they discuss the work. It's sometimes good, you know, to get a bit of an insight how they talk to each other and how they're criticized. Because criticism is good, but it is a different thing if somebody gives a good criticism or if you stand up there and they are just, you know, finishing off this poor student. Or on the other hand, nobody says anything. So maybe joining a group for a lab meeting or so can great insight in how they're working.
Sure. Thank you. That's really helpful. And it's good to know about the environment. And I guess you'll find that out by speaking to other people who work there, isn't it?
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Absolutely. And it's a growing process, you know. So I think one thing is also, don't expect that everything now and immediately from the beginning is perfect and that that it will always be like this, you know. You learn and projects develop and it's a learning process. So give yourself time also to settle in and to find your way. And sometimes there's a dead end. Who cares? Also, don't take it too seriously, you know. Sometimes for me it's good when I'm frustrated or I think I'm stuck. Go away, do something completely else. You see the world out there, there's culture, there is sports, there is social life, and they all exist without their PhD project, and they don't even know what you are doing, you know, and for them. Yeah. So put it in a bit of a relation, you know, your life doesn't depend on this. It's a big part, but there are other things in life, and then you come back and then you're a bit more relaxed on that not everything works out and not everything seems to be always great.
Sure. Thanks very much. That's really helpful. Thank you.
Other questions or other that if you want to ask in the last minutes?
Yeah, I have a short one. Well, I don't know if it's short. Well, but Caroline, you were talking a bit about collaborative work, seeking other people's or their competences and skills. So I was just wondering, I'm doing a bit of that also, of course, but how is it best to approach like a PI? Should it be PI to PI, or how do you see the, because sometimes it's kind of hard to navigate being a PhD or postdoc, how and who you can approach and how that goes. So just some thoughts on that would be awesome.
Yeah. So that's really delicate because you always have to, of course, at some point involve the PI. It can be strange if PhD students make a deal among each other and the PIs don't even work. But a great thing to connect first is with the PhD student or with people, you know, and then just discuss first things and then really quickly involve the PIs, you know. And this is sometimes often easier than to go directly to the PI, who probably will not answer your mail. But you should always at a certain point involve the PI, of course. I mean, what you cannot do is just, you know, do some networking without, or some collaboration without involving the PI. But as a start, I think it's often better to approach somebody on your level. And then once you said, oh yeah, this could work, then you together with your PI and then plan this. And then they also might say again, okay, you two do this. But be careful, you're not to leave them out. Because it's really strange. What happened to me sometimes is that people come to me and said, oh yes, you know, the person from your group actually sent me samples. I'm like, I didn't even know, you know. And that's really something you don't want as a PI. So keep them always informed, but to initiate this really good.
Thank you very much for your kindness for now and for sharing this experience.
Wow. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.